Hello, everyone, and welcome to another edition of Mormon Stories Podcast. I am your host, John DeLynn. It is November 2nd, 2021, and today we have for you yet another much-anticipated episode with the one, the only, the John Larsen. What's your middle initial, John?
H.
John H. What does the H stand for?
My mom named me after Jesus.
Hamula? What?
Think about it, John. Come on.
Jesus.
Jesus H. Christ.
I'm slow. We just did a five-hour interview. I'm kind of wasted. What does the H stand for?
Nothing.
And really?
Yeah, I think my mom wanted me to be a general authority.
Okay. So literally the H stands for nothing?
My legal name is John H. Larsen. The H stands for Hillary, who is my great-grandfather.
Okay. All right. Well, welcome. We're mm-hmm. so glad to have you here today. My listeners in general, 90%+ are over the moon about you being on Mormon Stories Podcast. I would say the number of people who have become donors outweigh the number who have stopped because of your appearances on Mormon Stories. How does that feel? That you're a net positive, basically, overall.
Well, I think if your goal in life is to donate money in order to try to control the content of what you're donating money to, take your money.
I love it.
No, I'm glad I can be helpful. I think this is important.
Yeah, it is. So I'm in all seriousness, I'm really honored that you are a part of Mormon Stories these days, and we're loving your content. Last episode was really epic, but before we jump into that, I also have to welcome as our sidekick, the one, the only, Carah Burrell.
Hey, Carah. Oh, me. Hey. Hello, Johns. Pleasure to see you both again.
You told me that you've been waiting a month for today.
Is that Everyone true? Is. Yeah. This is just the way that it goes now, Mormon Stories. It's John DeLynn. It's John DeLynn Day is every day, but it's John Larsen Day today.
Yeah, it's John Larsen Day.
I take umbrage with the sidekick. If you take the number of words that it takes the three of us to get a point across, she wins by far. I mean, totally. Her word to point. Yes, you did. Her word to point ratio is about 10 words and mine's about 138.
All right. My boss, I'll start. Hey, everyone, welcome. My boss, Carah Burrell, my superior.
And all I have to say to that is let's get started.
Okay. All right. Well, so John, today the episode is about James Strang.
Yeah, Jesse James.
Who some would say was supposed to be Joseph Smith's successor, but there are all sorts of reasons why James Strang is super interesting and important. But you titled today's episode what?
The King of Beaver Island.
And I'm sure there are all sorts of meanings in that.
Well, yeah, we'll get there.
Okay. But before we dive into talking about James, is it James J. Strang? Is
that well, right? There's some controversy. It seems that his big, because, and I'm not going to get this point later, but he had some revelations that identified that James would be the successor or whatever. But it seems that his birth name was Jesse James Strang, and he switched the names. But, you know, at the time, people would switch their names and change the spelling all the time. So, I'm not going to definitively say his birth certificate was James Jesse or Jesse James, but Jesse James sounds better, right?
It sounds great. Sounds very American Western frontier.
Yes, all that. Very outlawish.
Kara,
I was just going to say, I think Jesse James, he's quite the ladies' man, right?
I don't know.
I think he was the King of Beaver Island.
Okay,
you mean the OG Jesse James?
Sounds like we're going to be giving a PG-13 rating today to Mormon Stories Podcast. So like if you have sensitive ears, if you don't like language or occasional sexual innuendo, not on the part of me, of course,
but wait, if you don't like language or sexual innuendo, you're lame. What kind of person doesn't like sexual innuendo?
You've wandered onto a John Larsen podcast and you are in for some treats.
Yeah. Just buyer beware. So today's episode will range from a PG-13 to an R rating, depending on how spicy John is feeling. Although, John, you said you think I'm feeling spicy.
Yeah, right? Yeah. John's a little bit pissy tonight, so everyone be cautious.
All right.
Well, sometimes I think I got you going last time.
Laughing or
either way, either to get you all riled up or get you laughing is my goal in life.
One of these days we have to do live episodes where like we have a studio audience. You used to do that, right?
Yeah, yeah. I'm waiting for the plague to end. Right. Basically. But yeah, I think spring, summer, we definitely should get a live show in.
All right. Well, one of the things you like to do as we kick off is kind of talk about feedback and comments from previous episodes. So should we jump in there or where do you want to begin?
Yeah, yeah. First of all, because the rumors are out, I thought it would, I'd take the opportunity to confirm. I have left the state of Utah. I have moved out of Utah. I now live in Oregon.
And I'm going, no.
Well, some people might be happy about it. Some people may not, but so it shouldn't interrupt our show here. We're planning on keep doing it. Matter of fact, when John approached me, I told him that I was interviewing for a job in Oregon. But yeah, my family's moving to Oregon for various reasons that maybe we'll get to in the future. But I wish you all well, and I say a fond adieu to Salt Lake City, my former home.
We're gonna miss you, and we hope to see you as frequently or more as always.
Well, the Mormon verse goes from, you know, Canada all the way down to the colonies in Mexico. That you can't just leave Mormondom.
So you're not totally.
No.
Okay, so that's announcement one.
Oh, that's announcement two. So the last episode, which we did on the handcart companies, there was a lot of visceral reaction to that episode, obviously on my part too. I have a few principles that I live by now. One, of course, is that we talked about a few episodes ago, which is, you know, do a little bit better, do less harm. And another one that I espouse is clean up your messes. One of the reasons that I kind of drifted away or ended the podcast, there were several reasons back in 2014, was we deal with a lot of anger and outrage here. And anger is, and so I have to do some cleaning up because I released, and I am actively releasing a lot of anger into the universe here. Anger and outrage, it's a scalpel. It's an important tool, and it's an evolutionary key element of what it means to be human, to be angry, to be outraged at things that shouldn't have happened, to have these feelings is good and proper, but they are toxic and you can't carry them. You have to shed the anger. And it's just like the scalpel. The scalpel can help heal, but it won't heal itself. Healing takes place elsewhere. So I implore those of you who are engaging with me on these short journeys into outrage, because it was outrageous what happened. It is outrageous what's still happening. And your anger is justified. But you have to promise me, if you're going to listen, that you're going to work on working through the anger. And we were chatting a week or so ago that I think soon here we want to do an episode on dealing with the anger. I know we've had a lot of you know, psychologists and psychiatrists over the years talk about these things, but it's not something to be neglected. As you're dealing with your transition, wherever you land, wherever you end, you have to deal with the anger, and you can't stay here. This is a spot to visit. This is a spot to walk through. It is not a spot to live. It'll eat you up.
Yeah. Yeah. So we confront the hard stuff, but we also do our self-care, mental health processing, and healing and growth.
We have to.
Yeah.
It's not optional.
Yeah.
And staying in this space too long will poison you.
Yeah.
Yeah. And you, I know from, I'm talking to John many times over the years that you guys do a lot of dealing with this, that probably John's biggest job, frankly, I'm guessing, is to get himself into a healthy place when he's not dealing with this. And it's something that, you know, like EMS workers and psychologists, psychiatrists, people have to deal with all the time. And so it's important that it not take over.
Carrie, I think you feel that sometimes too, right?
Yeah. I mean, that combined with, we've been talking about how just this job is hard. Like, people accuse us of, you know, this is your only personality trait, being an ex-Mormon or being a podcaster. And sometimes you have to take on a lot of other people's emotions doing this job. So generally, it's just, it's good to work through it and have your own separate hobbies and interests, or else, yeah, it can't go anywhere good. So for sure, all of that.
But use it. Yeah. The anger is righteous and it's healthy, just in small doses.
Totally. All right. Thank you, John.
All right. I think those are all I had on my introduction. I don't think we had any.
I'll just say one last thing, and that's that first of all, thank you for Kimo Lewis for their super chat on YouTube. Those donations mean a lot. So thank you so much for anyone who throws us a bone over YouTube. I was just to talk quickly about the William Martin Handcart episode. Mm-hmm. I was really surprised at how visceral that was. And I know I'm being slightly repetitive, but I think there was a lot of people whose family, and I'm talking about people who've been ex-Mormon 5 or 10 or 20 years. Mm-hmm. I think there are people whose identity, their family lore, their family honor, their family narrative has been tied up in that story. Mm-hmm. And so I've been surprised at how many people, once they heard kind of a more factual recounting of what happened, just how disturbing it was to people.
It was. And I don't think it diminishes the sacrifice and the pioneer spirit or whatever the people tap into in their families. If anything, it should help you reverence your ancestors more, what they really sacrificed, what they really went through for sincere held beliefs, for a real attempt to find and build heaven on earth. For a real attempt to change their lives and change the world. And we can't addressing the mistakes and the incompetence of the leadership, we can't let that dim the light of those people.
Yeah. Yeah. I remember it being said that making idols out of our historical figures does them a disservice and does us a disservice. Mm-hmm. It puts them on a pedestal that they could never reach realistically up to. So it sets them up for a fall in our eyes.
Right.
And then it does us a disservice because we fail to realize what our potential is because we feel like, how can I compare to Superman?
Right.
And really, there is no Superman.
I historically, I really am fascinated by, you know, cathedrals and castles and bridges and viaducts and all these old structures that I have a reverence when I have the opportunity to go into those places. A few years ago, I started, because, you know, the castles were really built on the backs of, taking advantage of the poor and of greed and violence and all that kind of stuff. And it made me sort of feel bad about the admiration I had for those. Until I was reading something about stonemasons, actually, and then I realized, well, not a single one of those rich assholes built one of these buildings, one of those cathedrals. And when you go into a European cathedral, you're honoring the hundreds and thousands who sacrificed, the artisans, the skilled, everyday people whose names are completely lost. They're the ones who built the cathedrals. We, the people, are the ones who built the United States, who built Europe, who built China, who built all the things we have. And we unfortunately have this great man theory of history where we like to talk about the idols at the top. But I think that the joy of Mormonism, of the history of Mormonism for me, is the people. They were salty, they were weird, but they were interesting. It's the leaders at the top who need a spanking.
Yeah. Love it. Amen. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
All right.
Hallelujah.
All right, John. Well, let's see. Let me pull up our photo. Here's a photo of the man, the myth, the legend. Take it away.
Jesse Strang, James Strang. Okay. So we talked about our sources. My primary source for this evening is a book called The King of Beaver Island by Roger Van Noord. From the University of Illinois Press. It was published in 1988. It's an interesting read. I would recommend it.
We'll add it to the show.
Fairly even-handed approach. And then various internet sources to pull documents and review things and whatnot. Okay. There's something I want to ask you all right now. As we're about to go through this story, I want everybody who's listening, whether they're in the church or out of the church or anywhere along, I want you to pay close attention to the feelings that you have when we talk about James Strang's experience, there's going to be no, you know, we'll talk about it again at the end. So there's going to be kind of a little quiz, but there's no right answers because it's about what you feel. But I think this is an interesting chance for both people inside and outside the church to interrogate how they're reacting to this story. Do they think it's ridiculous? Do they think it's moving? Do they think, and we're going to come back to that. But I just want to plant that seed for everyone to sort of pay attention to what they're feeling about James's story here.
Yeah, and if listeners and viewers want that are joining us live, they can actually comment.
Sure, please.
And maybe Kara and I will monitor those comments and share them from time to time because that'll be fun. I think it's an important exercise just to develop emotional awareness. I think sometimes raised in a high-demand religion, we're nurtured to tamp down and ignore and suppress what we feel. And I think that's a good exercise generally.
I think you're right. I wouldn't use the word nurtured myself. We were conditioned to have certain emotional reactions. And I know for a lot of people, once they kind of discover or decide that the church is not true, at least as the church defines itself, they have to deal with a lot of unpacking of feelings. And that goes for things like relationships, family, sexuality, engaging the world, alcohol, all sorts of things that they have to really confront these feelings. For a lot of people, it's too much work. And they either don't deal with it or they run back into the church or whatever. But it's really important to interrogate these feelings because leaving the church takes a long time. You know, I would say usually about, I would say maybe a year or two for every decade you were in, it's going to be tough. And part of that work is really trying to understand the feeling and say, I wonder why I'm feeling that way. In the United States, oftentimes we're always trying to steer our feelings. So if we're feeling unhappy, we don't want to feel unhappy anymore, as opposed to saying, I feel unhappy. I wonder why that is. And I think this story is a good chance to interrogate some of those feelings.
Love it. All right.
Okay. Jesse James Strang was born on March 21st, 1813 in Upper State, New York.
What was the year again?
1813.
Okay.
So he was
younger than Joseph
Smith. 8 years younger than Joseph Smith. And he came from that same burned over district, a district that was within, you know, a generation or two had been taken from the Iroquois. And so you're talking about new, invaders into, former broken people's land. And it was a time of speculation and, it was the Wild West, right? Really that place up there in that time. And, it led to a lot of religious speculation, both because of the two twin ideas at the time, you know, the idea that Christianity could be re-engaged directly, you know, that you could get to God directly by using the Bible, and of course, American exceptionalism, that somehow with this whole American experiment was a gift from God. And this land was God's gift, and the people who came here were led here by the hand of God. I mean, that shows up over and over again. Well, that affected people's psychology. They really started to believe that stuff. Still do, most of them. Americans.
But you're saying the Book of Mormon didn't originate that idea?
No. The you know, it goes all the way back. Look at the pilgrims looking for their religious exceptionalism. You know, the pilgrims didn't come here to practice religious freedom. That's a lie you've been told. They came here to practice their religion, and because they have the true and right religion, and God help you if you didn't follow along, the punishments were of the utmost, right?
Yeah.
Okay. He had become, I think I read that he had practiced an attorney and he'd become a Baptist minister not too long before he went rolling into Nauvoo. He's described as a slight man. He was tiny, he was small, and he was not really a vain man. As a matter of fact, when we talk about his coronation, his crown was made of tin. And he was described often as having like worn out or dilapidated clothing, and even when he had more money, he still kind of was dressed shabbily. He's described generally as being very intelligent, and you know, it's clear that he picked up on a lot of the same language and other stuff either Joseph Smith was tapping into or that he mimicked from Smith himself. He wandered into Nauvoo February 1844 to see what all the hubbub was about and found himself baptized by Joseph Smith in the temple on February 25th and ordained an elder on March 2nd of 1844 by Hiram Smith.
44. Okay.
So, and that's a good segue to the next point. Let's talk about Nauvoo, late winter, 1844. This place was hot. And I mean that in every sense of the word. We're at this time, we're probably pushing a population of about 25,000 people in and around Nauvoo. And at the time, the scholars say the population exceeded Chicago. So we have a lot of people coming in. By this time, Joseph Smith had had himself secretly crowned king of the world, basically. And he had had himself bestowed with the rank of lieutenant general, which is like a very rare, like Napoleon, I think, was a lieutenant general or something. But Joseph Smith in the 1840s tended to wear his parade dress uniform all the time. He would walk around with a sword on, and William Law and Miller and those guys, the stake president and some other high level people in the church, were starting to openly question Smith. By this time, Smith had married well over 30 women, most of them in secret. Some of them were married to Smith and they had kept it secret from their husbands. At the time of his assassination in June 27th of 1844, the 12 had all been sent out there. They weren't in Nauvoo at the time, and they had been sent out to campaign for Joseph Smith's presidency. So Joseph Smith had at this time given himself the highest rank. No one's ever achieved that rank in the military in the United States, and he had an actual military, which is one of the reasons the Carthage Greys and other people were really concerned. So there was a lot of secret stuff going on and speculation. When we talk about speculation, I know this word gets thrown around by scholars talking about Nauvoo all the time. What this means is rather than actually building the city, what a lot of people were doing is trying to acquire land to hold it for a couple months to flip it and make money. The problem is when a city is in a big mode of speculation, building actually slows down in Nauvoo, which is one of the problems, because why would you take time to build a mill when if you just sit here for 6 months, you can get rich by reselling your property? And there were competitions between the lower ward of Nauvoo and the upper ward, and there were just financial entanglements, military entanglements, sexual entanglements, and Joseph was running to the end of the line. I mean, it was pretty clear that it was not going to end well for him, right? Strang walks in, and he at the time, because of the building of Nauvoo, the Mormons were looking for inexpensive building materials, really, because that was one of the problems on the frontier, was trying to get lumber and nails and all that stuff out towards them. So they had started setting up these kind of missions around that were like timber missions. So a little colony would be established to provide for a resource. Strang kind of looked around a little bit, and he saw a need. So he came to Joseph Smith and said, "Hey, look, I want to head up to up north of here, up to Wisconsin, and start a colony, you know, to help us get some resources and all of that." Joseph said to him, "Oh, sounds like a great idea. Why don't you give me a written proposal on what this would look like?" And Strang did, and he wrote this whole thing up, and he completed it on May 24th. So the reason I'm really tracking these dates is things go really nuts here this summer. So May 24th, by this time, the whistling deacons are hanging out in the streets. Now, this is a story I was told as a kid, that they would have the deacons stand on the corners, whittling, they would say, watching for the apostates. Now, at the time, the Aaronic priesthood was not a youth program of the church. So the deacons were all grown men. And when they were whittling, they were doing it with Bowie knives. It was a definite threat. So you have Joseph Smith's thugs standing on the corner with knives, you know, and then they would whistle to each other when the people they thought were Confederate with William Law and those other guys would walk by. So violence was heating up, but it was really tense at this moment.
And I don't know if you've already said this, but had the Nauvoo Expositor first edition dropped yet or not quite yet? So you're saying William Law had apostatized, but maybe hadn't yet.
Well, dropped. William Law never really apostatized. And I you'll forgive me because I don't have those elements right in front. I think the Expositor dropped in June, but I'm not certain. Maybe somebody can look it up and put it in the chat.
Okay.
But the battle lines had been drawn.
Okay.
Like people knew where the alliances were. And it was about really not just the polygamy, but it was about, because the polygamy also, it would be unfair to call it polygamy. From the point of view of most people, they just knew that illicit sex was going on. And when we say illicit, you know, we're talking about the church authorities sleeping with women who were married to other men. Now, please, this is my reminder to ex-Mormons, please, please, please stop saying that Joseph Smith slept with other men's wives. It is a sexist construction. Stop it.
Because
these women were agents unto themselves and human beings who could make their own choices within the construction of their time. But it erases the agency of the women. And there's a reason for that. We're going to turn back to it in a minute here, unfortunately. My only point is that Joseph Smith knows things are going crazy here, and he's starting to look for some outs. They're starting to scout out about heading west. They're looking for different places to go. And they just have a lot of people. This movement had become extremely successful at this point in time. Okay, so he proposes, Strang proposes on May 24th that they set up a colony in the Burlington area, and they eventually make a colony named Voree, I think is how it's pronounced. It doesn't exist anymore. It is in Burlington, Wisconsin, is where the site of the city is. Burlington is about 35 miles south of Milwaukee, 35 miles south west of Milwaukee, about 80 miles northwest of Chicago. So if that gets in your mind, it is a little bit inland, but we're on the kind of shores of Lake Michigan. Okay. Very timber rich country, a lot of still, you know, Indian artifacts and that sort of stuff that hadn't been long removed from the land. So the Joseph Smith pens a letter to Jesse James Strang, making his appointment, and it is called the appointment letter. And I will send those of you who care down a rabbit hole. There's been a lot of discussion and controversy on this particular letter. I will say this: the letter was authenticated by Emma. Emma said that was Joseph Smith's handwriting. There is some question about the signature, but that becomes a really difficult issue for those who track these things, because Joseph tended to have things written by scribes, and Joseph had a strange habit of also having scribes sign his name. So we have a lot of authentic signatures of Joseph Smith that were signed by other people. But by all accounts, there are some active Brighamites who this day still claim the letter was a forgery. There is no indication that the letter was a forgery. It matches Joseph Smith's style. It's been authenticated. It was postmarked June 19th from Nauvoo, and that postmark has been authenticated. And it showed up Jesse or Strang got it on September 1st, 1845, which would have been 3 days after Joseph Smith was murdered. So the letter was in transit to that time. So we're talking about the appointment letter. This was, again, the letter that Joseph Smith wrote to James Strang. Dated Nauvoo, June 18th, 1844. I'm going to jump to the second paragraph here, because it's a fascinating paragraph. This is the words of Joseph Smith. I have long felt that my present work was almost done and that I should be called to rule a mighty host. But something whispers me it will be in the land of spirits, where the wicked cease from troubling and the bands of the prisoner fall off. My heart yearns for my little ones, but I know God will be a father to them. And I can claim to face the fulfillment of promises from him who is a covenant-keeping God, and who sweareth and performeth and faileth not to the uttermost. For believers, and but there still are people who believe in the Strang faction, this is the Joseph Smith prophesied his own death a week and a half before it happened. To them, it speaks to the prophetic nature of this letter. To me, it speaks to the idea that Joseph knew he was in a lot of hot water. You know, the things weren't going so well. And by the way, I'm going to make a footnote here on construction. It gets cumbersome to say alleged and supposed, and that he contended that. So we're just going to talk that angels visited him and all that kind of stuff. I'm not making a comment on whether these things are true or not in my grammar on that. Okay. The wolves are upon my scent, and I'm waiting to be offered up, he continues, and you know, he goes on like that. What's funny is he code switches in this letter from first person to second person, and he drops into a revelation. That's where we're going to pick it up. And now behold, my servant James J. Strang hath come to thee from far for truth, where he know not, and hath not rejected it, but hath faith in thee, the shepherd and stone of Israel. And to him shall the gathering of the people be, for he shall plant a stake of Zion in Wisconsin, and I will establish it. And there shall my people have peace and rest, and shall not be moved. For it shall be established on the prairie on White River, in the lands of Racine and Walworth. And behold, my servant James and Aaron shall plant it, for I have given them wisdom, and Daniel shall stand in his lot on the hill beside the river, looking down on the prairie, and shall instruct my people, and shall plead with them face to face. So this is very Joseph Smith here, where he switches directly into speaking directly for God. And whenever Joseph Smith speaks in the voice of God, God always gives Joseph a little pat on the back a little bit. This is my boy here.
Really loves
Joseph Smith. Right. You know, because when you are dictating the voice of the divine, the first thing the divine wants to know is that the dictator is really a good guy, right? But what this does establish is that for the Strangites, that God is appointing this place by revelation. This is God's will. And God even speaks of the plains of Racine. I've been to Racine, Wisconsin. I don't know how much, but God thinks they're great, right? The plains of Racine. Okay. And then God goes on, but again, I will stretch out my arm over the rivers of water, and the banks thereof shall the house of my choice be. But now the city of Voree, and I think it's pronounced Voree, it's spelled V-O-R-E-E, and it was named by Joseph Smith. And he, somewhere along the line, I didn't write it down here, gave some kind of cockamamie definition of it, like Deseret or something like that. But now the city of Voree shall be a stronghold of safety to my people, and they that are faithful and obey me, I will there give them great prosperity, and such as they have not had before. And unto Voree shall be the gathering of my people. And there shall the oppressed flee for safety, and none shall hurt or molest them. This is very important. This is going to become pivotal in about a week from these guys' timeline. Because things are going south, really, after Joseph Smith dies. Things in Nauvoo go from worse to worse. So here is God saying he appointed Voree, Wisconsin, as the gathering place for safety. I'm going to skip ahead. For great calamities are coming on the church, and such as have never been. And if they scatter, the ungodly of the world shall swallow them up. But if they gather to my city of Voree, there will I keep them under the shadow of my wings. And the city from whence my people have been driven shall be purged with a high hand. For I will do it, and my people shall again restored to their possessions, but dark clouds are gathering, for the church is not yet wholly purged. And now I command my servants, this is a key paragraph here. And now I command my servants, the apostles and priests and elders of the church of the saints, that they communicate and proclaim this. my word to all the saints of God in all the world, that they may be gathered unto and round about the city of Vori and be saved from their enemies, for I will have a people to serve them. So those paragraphs really establish the contention point here. So remember, by the time Strang is reading this, Joseph Smith is dead, although he won't find that out for a couple more days. So he gets this, you can imagine from Strang's perspective, he gets in his hand a letter from Joseph predicting his own death. And by the time he has the letter, Joseph Smith is dead. And Joseph Smith not only says the Vori will be a gathering place for the saints, it'll be a gathering place because of the tumult that's just about to come to the saints. And he says that the apostles and priests and elders of the church are to proclaim to the world that they should gather to Vori. That's what the letter clearly says. So for Strang, this letter was the first in his series of claims to say that the mantle of the prophet had fallen upon him. Now, you know, let's talk a little bit about mystics. Religions are always started by mystics and perpetuated by priests. So priests are always concerned about obedience and orthodoxy, what's in and what's out. Mystics are not ever really concerned about that as much. You know, those who study Joseph Smith or people like him, they're not necessarily rule followers themselves, and they like to bend and break rules some. So what we have, and I'm kind of previewing, is for the members of the church, they're going to be presented with a stark choice pretty soon here. Do we go and follow another mystic, or do we follow Brigham Young, who was a calculated company man? And who in the beginning claimed he was not the prophet, that there was only one prophet. And in the beginning, in the Nauvoo days, Young merely said he was sort of the guardian of the church and the 12 were in charge of it, but they weren't prophetic in the same way Joseph was. Young modified and changed that message over time. But here you have Joseph Smith appointing Strang to set up the stake. Now, the word stake in Mormonism has changed quite a bit, so we should probably define the original term. For a stake is a stake, like a tent pole stake. That's what they meant when they devised the word stake. And I think the word is used in the Bible somewhere in the Old Testament in a similar fashion. But when you have stakes, you have a center pole in the tent, and then this tent is pulled taut, and then you hammer the stake in. But the center pole is what keeps the tent up. For Joseph Smith's analogy, the center pole is and always was only one thing: Jackson County, Missouri. It was Zion. It was the center gathering place. And then all the stakes of Zion were these elements that radiated out from. So that's one of the counter arguments to the people saying this letter appointed Strang to be the new president or new leader of the church, because he also identifies it as being one of the stakes of Zion. However, at the time, nobody was in Jackson County, so every single place was a stake of Zion, which the church has continued that mode to this day, right? So by appointing him to be the stake, and what's interesting is Joseph didn't always have a lot of following his own rules, because in this letter he clearly says that Strang is going to be the stake president. We kind of skipped that section, and he appointed somebody to be his counselor, but they didn't really kind of follow through. But we should have to we should remember that these positions were not well defined at this time at all. The stake presidents, that didn't really come about for quite some time. The bishops had a lot more power. So when Joseph Smith was writing this letter, it wasn't really well defined what a stake president or what a stake was. He doesn't even identify him as a stake president. That's a more modern construction. So the appointment letter is the first big piece of evidence for those who choose to follow Strang.
Does this mean that Joseph just was super impressed with Strang? Was Joseph writing these letters to everybody? Like, you know, I don't remember. Well, of course, I don't remember hearing about Strang growing up, because the church would want a deep six anything about him, I'm sure. But, you know, to what extent did they really have a meaningful relationship or a deep connection? Or was Joseph really liking the guy? I mean, we know that he made William Law, like co-president, pretty quickly, relatively quickly, at some point, right?
Well, Joe, this was Joseph's MO. You know, he would glom onto somebody who could give him something.
Sidney Rigdon.
First one is Martin Harris. Yeah. Then Martin Harris had the money, and then it was Oliver Cowdery who acted as a scribe, and there was the second elder. And then when they went to Kirtland, it was Sidney Rigdon who became the co-president of the church, and it happened. William Bennett. Happened in Nauvoo where
John C. Bennett?
Yeah, John Bennett. I'm sorry. No, just making sure. John Bennett, and he rose right up to the top of the church. So it is not
William Law was the first president.
Joseph Smith would meet somebody, be impressed with them, and immediately elevate them and bestow them with all sorts of power and authority.
Yeah.
So it is not out of the question, given especially what he did with John Bennett and what he did with Sidney Rigdon, that Joseph might have been appointing him to be. And Joseph was not trusting anybody at this time. There are those who argue that him sending the 12 out of the city was not just about his presidential campaign. It was about getting them away. Because some of the 12 had become involved in plural marriage. And of course they were Council of 50, and the Council of the Anointed. So in Nauvoo, there were secret societies on secret societies on secret societies. And so it's not weird that Joseph Smith would do this. If you want to say, no, that's not at all what he would do, is appoint this guy who came rolling in. Well, then I present the case of John C. Bennett, sure, which we'll go through John C. Bennett in a future episode. He's a man that deserves a lot of discussion.
His own episode.
Yes, indeed.
Absolutely.
Okay. So, all right. Let's talk about, so that's his appointment. So Strang gets up there and people do start gathering up to him. As a matter of fact, there is a mission sent. There are two missions back and forth. So in Nauvoo, over the next year before the Saints leave, there are houses burned, there are skirmishes, there are murders, there's violence, killing of cattle, like going back and forth. And it's not just like the Grays against the Mormons. It was Mormon on Mormon violence, just like it always had been. That these movements, these kind of high intensity cults that form around, they always fall apart spectacularly. So things were getting really kind of crappy in Nauvoo. And of course, Voree was just up the road. So at one point, the Voree Saints send four missionaries down to Nauvoo, and they get out by the skin of their teeth. They were preaching at the preaching rock or whatever it was, and all these Mormons come up with pistols and knives, and these guys kind of like hightail it out in their head. So the Brigham sends two missionaries up, a guy named Reuben Smith, who's there to go correct the Voree Saints, and Strang converts Reuben Smith, and shortly thereafter converts John E. Page, who is a sitting member of the 12. So there was a big feather in Strang's hat. Suddenly, he's got a sitting member of the 12 in his camp. Okay, so now we'll fast forward a little bit to the next year, September 1st, 1845. On September 1st, 1845, an angel appears. Now we should. I think I wrote this down, but I'm not seeing it here. I've got it. My notes were a little bit out of order. I apologize for my chaos. Strang claims that at 5:30 p.m. on June 27th, 1844, an angel appeared to him and said, "Thou shalt save his people from their enemies and prepare a refuge for the oppressed and for the poor and the needy." That is Strang's first recorded angelic visitation, which he said happened basically at the simultaneous with the death of Joseph Smith. I don't remember exactly what the time of death is, but it was in the afternoon. Now, of course, this is what he says later. Color me skeptical, because you know he still hadn't even got the letter or whatever.
This is probably putting too fine a point on it, and I think you're wanting people to kind of draw their own conclusions. But now it's time to kind of start turning on the brain about in what ways does James Strang kind of parallel Joseph Smith's behaviors, his actions, his approaches, his techniques. And number one, believing listeners or listeners have to ask themselves, what does it mean that Joseph Smith gave his prophetic endorsement to James Strang in the letter, which basically says, hey, whatever Strang does, Joseph is a prophet.
Not just seer, Joseph, God.
He's a revelator. Right, God. Exactly. That's even better. Yeah. So like God has now sanctioned James Strang through Joseph Smith, through that revelation. So that's parallel one. So believers theoretically should be going, whoa, I need to care about James Strang, even though I never did before. But then secondly, now that James Strang is going to start producing revelations and other things, obviously believers and listeners have to start saying, well, what's the difference between what Strang starts doing and what Joseph Smith was doing all along?
If God has a pattern to select prophets, well, that's an interesting theory. And let's see how well Strang follows that pattern. Because, you know, one of Joseph Smith's first thing was to say that an angel visited him and appointed him to this role, and take my word for it.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah. But there's no evidence anything happened. There's no witnesses, no nothing. Joseph just says, this is what happened to me, as does Strang. Right.
Yeah.
But it's going to get kookier here in a minute. I'm telling you, hold out. Okay. So he does that. An angel appears to Strang on September 1st, 1845. And Strang never identifies the angel by name, but the angel gives him the Urim and Thummim and tells him
that, because the angel had taken it back from Joseph.
The angel had taken it back
from Joseph. So it was available.
It was available. So the angel gives Strang the Urim and Thummim, and he gives him a vision and shows him a hill where there are plates hidden near White River, Vori.
More plates. Awesome.
Okay. So Strang sees this in a vision, and Strang gathers together four witnesses, one of which who later invented the typewriter, actually. And by the way, these four witnesses never recounted their account of what is about to happen.
Ooh.
So four witnesses.
That lends extra credibility.
Four witnesses, and they all wrote this down, and some of them apostatized. I've heard apologists make the argument that the witnesses for Joseph Smith are more believable because they left the church. And if they really hated Joseph Smith, this wasn't true, then they would have denied what they said happened. So Strang leads them over to the hill where there is a tree. And this tree is said to be 1 foot in diameter. That big around. Okay. So we're talking a tree that's 20 or 30 years old. And he invites them to look around to see if the ground had been disturbed at all. Strang goes and sits on a rock and eats an apple or something. He does not touch the tree. The four men knock the tree down and take shovels and start digging. And by their account, they dig through the topsoil and into the clay. Again, they all say the land was completely undisturbed and this was under a tree. The problem with being a prophet is there's always another prophet who's going to one-up you right down the line. I'm just saying that. If you're considering this as a career, just know that whatever you say, somebody's going to one-up it. Okay, they dig down the clay, and then they hit what they said was a rock that was about 1 foot square. They lift the rock up off, and they find a clay box. They said that it had been baked clay, and they lift out three plates of brass. By their account, they were small and about, I think, 1.5 inches by 1 inch. We do not have pictures of these plates. They went missing in about 1900, but we do have drawings of them. And I think I asked you to queue up. If you are at home while John is fiddling around with his computer, you can go to a computer and type in Vore plates on Google, or my preferred browser, DuckDuckGo. And you can see images of what the plates look like, the drawings. I have mine here, but I dropped it on the floor. So forgive me. I'm going to dive here a second.
And viewers and viewers on both Facebook and YouTube can see at least a couple of the plates.
Yeah. So there are six images, three plates.
Are these like lithographs? Like what? These photographs?
They are carved or etched in the brass.
Okay.
A later observer of the plate. So we had, they were around for about 60 years.
They were for lots of people. So no angel took them back up.
They were observed by people, and we have drawings. These drawings are scale drawings of them, and Strang translated them.
I mean, that's even more credible than the gold plates, because they stayed around.
Yes.
There was no sort of angel took them away before you got to see them kind of thing.
Correct.
That's okay. How you know that it wasn't from God, because God's MO is to take them away.
God just wouldn't want to give you the ability to not have
faith. But God did take them away in 1900 before the internets came around, so we could get faith checkmate, Kara.
God was busier that time.
Right.
He had some things to do.
So the plates, there's six images. One of them has a picture of some rolling hills that are supposed to be this place that they buried him. And four of them have a squiggly sort of Hebrew kind of looking text. It is not the same text we see on the Anton script. Is that what it's called? But the same sort of gibberidoo. Lots of dots and things. I would say, as I'm not an expert, my undergraduate degree was in linguistics. I've looked at a lot of languages, especially Sanskrit-based languages, Bali and stuff. This does not look like a natural language to me, for various reasons. Like a natural language, the more strokes that you have on a character, the less likely you are to write the character. So if you're looking at Japanese kanji or whatever, if it has one stroke or two strokes or three strokes, those are really common. So when you look at text in writing, be it Greek or Roman or Japanese or whatever, the more complicated a character is, the less likely you'll see it in frequency, because human beings are lazy. And so, but this doesn't seem, and they are also, you can tell by the language how they actually produced. So old Roman script is very structured, because you would chisel it, right? And the same way with cuneiform, it was pushed into, so there's things we know about language. These and Joseph Smith's do not conform. They don't look like natural language to me. Think of what it is. Okay. So, let's see. They pull them out. They find the thing. They're made of brass, and he tells them this is the writings of Raja Manchu of Orito. Raja Manchu of Orito.
I mean, why not? Right? Why not?
How is that any crazier than Moroni, the Raja?
It's like Raja Ghul from Batman.
Right.
Sounds like a guy that I met at a commune once.
There's a lot to unpack there.
It sounds like part two of Mormon Stories with Carah Burrell.
Was he a magic man? Did you write home to mom about him?
No, he had his own off-brand of Doritos called Rajitos.
Okay, you are blessed tonight, because I am going to read you the translation of these plates.
Did you make this translation, or was this James Strang's?
This is Strang's translation.
Oh, so it's a prophet's translation.
Yes. My people are no more. This is in the voice, just to make sure, this is in the voice of Raja Manchu of Vorito.
Okay.
Why are you laughing, John?
Yes, I mean, it's
you are a Mormon.
Absurd.
How dare you?
Hey, this is actual scripture of a real religious group right now.
Or
this,
it's someone's sacred beliefs.
So, this, you know, is someone's sacred beliefs, yeah, that you are laughing at.
Hey, you're laughing too, you bastard.
Well, I'm laughing at you, laughing at them, because my heart's broken. All right. My people are no more. The mighty are fallen, and the young slain in battle. Their bones bleached on the plain by the noonday shadow. The houses are leveled to the dust, and in the moat are the walls. They shall be inhabited. I have in the burial served them, and their bones in the death shade. Towards the sun's rising are covered. They sleep with the mighty dead, and they rest with their fathers. They have fallen in transgression or not, but the elect and faithful there shall dwell. The word hath revealed it. God hath sworn to give an inheritance to his people where transgressors perished. The word of God came to me. I'm reading holy word. Will you just, okay. You're praying. All right. Same. Okay. The word of God came to me while I mourned to the death shade, saying, I will avenge me on the destroyer. He shall be driven out. Other strangers shall inhabit the land. Okay, now we're getting into Mr. DeLynn. Don't maybe come over there. Wait, we're getting to the money shot here. Don't lose it early.
Sorry.
Okay. The escape of my people, there shall dwell, let's see. He shall be driven out. Other strangers shall inhabit the land. Now he's talking about Vori, right? I am an ensign there, will set up. That's what it says here on my page. I don't know if it's a sick or whatever. The escaped of my people, there shall dwell where the flock disowned the shepherd and built not on the rock. The forerunner man shall kill. The forerunner man shall be killed, but a mighty prophet there shall dwell. I will be his strength, and he shall bring forth thy record. Wait, record my name, words, and bury it in the hill of promise.
Is there any chance his name is James?
So I'm yes. So the Rajah, Mr. DeLynn.
We just talked about Big Tent Mormonism earlier. Yeah. Are there some Strangites right. possibly watching?
There are. Yeah. There
we're so cold-hearted.
There are a few left. And they this is their other claim of victory. They actually have the copyright on the name The Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. They are The Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. The Salt Lake Brighamites are Latter-day. But these guys are ladder, full stop, capital D.
Whoa. Day,
right?
They're the big D's, basically.
They're the big D's. Yes. And the
why are you laughing?
So the Rajah
of Beaver Island.
The Rajah himself appoints.
Oh, we just went off the rails.
Predicts the from the grave that Joseph Smith will die and that another will come in his place, right? For Mormons, again, that is the Joseph's ascent to leadership is predicted in the Book of Mormon, the book that he translated from records that he found in the ground. But Joseph didn't move a tree, yo. And there was nobody there.
Yo.
Yeah. There was nobody there to observe him dig it up. He just showed him the plates later, right? Yeah,
none of this like spiritual eyes garbage.
Let's review this because you've all been through Sunday school. Four witnesses. Never
not just three.
Not just three. Four.
I want everyone, sometimes they take comedy and they make it into like a cartoon. I would do that and I would draw you arguing with like a missionary and pretending to be a Strangite or something, being like, hey, listen, Mormon. I've got to tell you about my prophet.
They're out there. You can go to Burlington and the Strangites are still out there.
Yeah. Cause, okay. Make your case.
And before anybody, I want to know, I equally disrespect everybody. You notice I am saying Strangite, but I also say Brighamite. So
he's an equal opportunity offender.
Yes. Yes. Okay.
So not three witnesses, but four.
Three. Underneath the tree. Strang just sits there eating a ding dong. Yo, he's like, hey, go over there and dig it up.
It's not just that. Joseph dug it up by himself, so he could have created them.
He could have.
But in their case, it's four witnesses watching the dude dig up the plates.
Which they showed openly to people.
With their physical hands and eyes, not their spiritual eyes.
Right.
Or hands.
Right. Okay. And I want anybody to explain to me how he pulled this trick off. How in the world did he bury those things under a tree? Because I can give you lots of ways Joseph Smith pulled his tricks off. Matter of fact, one time he kept them in a box buried underneath the hearth, right? And so they knew that, right? So this gang breaks into Joseph Smith's house, pulls up the hearth, gets out the box, breaks it open, and it's full of what? Sand. Oh, well, joke's on you. I had removed the plates beforehand, and it was really just sand in there the whole time, neener, neener, right? But Strang does not need to reduce himself to such street magic tricks. He's full Chris Angel, right?
Okay.
I'm just going to let that sink in for a minute while I find my place.
Who's Chris Angel? Help me.
I don't know.
I was going to say David Blaine
street magician guy.
Okay.
Street magician. Just, mm-hmm. Somebody who's got big reveals. I was thinking more of a David Blaine kind of, or just somebody who's like something that they have been in the works for years. Somebody mm-hmm. who is have method actors take on a role. Maybe James Strang has been planning this since he was like 10 years old. You never know.
I don't know. I honestly don't have an explanation for this.
No, I mean, there's no explanation.
I don't find it convincing. I mean, but I don't have an explanation.
I'm getting there, though.
So Raja Manchu of Vorito was not the only ancient source.
What?
Later, the Strang was said that he had found the plates of Laban, which are not those plates of Laban. He called them the plates of Laban, but he said they dated to the pre-Babylonian era. That there are seven saints who were all apostles of Strang who claimed to have seen the plates of Laban. We don't have any record of them. And I do believe in the book of the law of the Lord, which is the scriptures that Strang wrote. He quotes from the book of Laban sometimes, but it's been a while. When I first studied these guys like 20 years ago, when I cared more about stuff like this, I did actually read some of the book of the law of the Lord, and it's just like you would think it would. Okay. All right. Let's move on. We still haven't gone to Beaver Island, right? Yeah. We're just getting rolling here.
Okay.
Oh, quick question from Kathleen. Kathleen. Did the witnesses sign their own name like Oliver Cowdery signing for all eight witnesses?
I don't know. I did not review their witness statements. So I'm reading a lot of secondhand material. I am not a firsthand researcher.
If into they the sign their name, another one up, right?
Yeah. But as far as I know, the witnesses stayed true. They never recanted.
All four
of them. Yeah, and then seven later, and then if you add Strang to the four, that gets five. Five plus seven is 12, and we know that 12 means something in Mormonism.
Man,
all right. Okay, so let's go back to Nauvoo a little bit. Succession talking about the succession crisis. You've probably done several episodes on Mormon stories over the years. It was really complicated. If not, we need to do one in the future. I don't think we have actually. The succession crisis was really kind of
Is there a Mormon Expression episode about the succession crisis?
I don't remember.
I guess our listeners can go search right now and tell us.
I know that we talked a lot about it when we did the Nauvoo Expositor, I would refer people to go find the old Expositor episodes, where we go through and talk about a lot of what was going on at the time. The succession was not clear. Joseph did not lay out a succession plan at all. And he left several ambiguous things, this being one of them, the Vore letter. Also, Joseph Smith implied more than once that his son would be take up the church. There are others who say it was the 12. But and if you really want to read about the succession crisis, then I recommend D. Michael Quinn's book, Mormonism, Origins of Power, or whatever. He really goes through the succession crisis, because the 12 and the 70 were equal in the original, in the Nauvoo period. They didn't exercise more power than the 70 did collectively. So they all start excommunicating each other around about now. And Strang was excommunicated on the 20 by the 12 on August 26th. Sidney Rigdon was excommunicated by the 12 on September 8th. So things are getting out of control. Brigham Young lost control of Nauvoo pretty damn quick, and which is why they headed out to winter quarters in the winter in late 45, 46.
And there was still Joseph Smith the third, who was a baby, but in line as
right.
Well.
Emma did not like Brigham Young at all. Not one bit. And Brigham was really trying to capture the Smith family, not capture like, well, in chains, but that led to some of the succession crisis, because it was not clear at all if they should follow the 12. So I just want to make the point briefly here, and it's a whole rabbit hole to go down, but the 12 did not have the power and authority in the church in the Nauvoo period that they later built in Utah. Okay. So Mormons were forbidden to either listen to any Vore missionaries, any Strangite missionaries, or to read the Vore Herald. So, I mean, that gives a indication. You know, they weren't even allowed to look at that stuff. All right, let's talk about Beaver Island. So, off in Lake Michigan, I don't know where it is. Beaver Island is the largest of the islands, and by this time, their beaver were extinct from the island. The trappers had killed them all. It is 58 square miles. So it's not an insignificant place, Beaver Island. And at the time, it was mostly not populated. The author writes a strange construction in the book. He says something like, the island was not populated except for the two villages there. And I couldn't figure out what the hell he was trying to say. So there were some trading posts, some fishing villages. I think people would come on the island and stay there for a short time and then get off. So he goes out to Beaver Island and declares that this is going to be the new home, which creates some controversy because there was just all this revelation about Voree. And they never completely abandon Voree, but Strang does leave Voree and move to Beaver Island to start setting up the church. There's a lot of intrigue and stuff that goes along, and we don't necessarily want to get into all of it as it gets more violent. But of note, So Strang starts making some doctrinal decisions, and a lot of what he makes were also ideas that were floated around by Young. So they're likely things that Smith was proposing. One of the key teachings of the church, and again, Brigham Young taught the same thing, was that Jesus was not born of virgin birth, and that Jesus was not sired by God. Now that belief bounces around quite a bit, but there's actually some biblical reason for saying that, because I think in Luke, I'm not a biblical scholar, but they in Matthew and Luke, there's two different genealogies given, and in one of them, I think the one that's in Mark, it establishes that Jesus is a descendant of David, so that he holds inheritance to the throne of Israel, basically. The problem with that is that the Israelis or the Jews practiced patrilinear succession. So it would matter not one whit that he was related to David through his mother. It would have to be through his father. But Strang taught that there wasn't a virgin birth, that Jesus was actually a descendant of David. And then Strang started teaching that he himself was a descendant of the same line. So implying that he was a descendant of Jesus, which again was not an unheard of belief in early Mormonism. I would dare say if you got him drunk, about 25% of conservative Mormons would tell you that Jesus had children. So it's not a strange belief, because early church leaders believed that they were descendants from Jesus Christ himself.
Totally.
Strang condemns polygamy, and because that was part of what blew everything up, until he meets Elvira.
All the prophets condemn polygamy at first.
Elvira,
including Joseph,
aka right? Charlie.
Well, no, but I mean, this is another parallel. Joseph in the Book of Mormon kind of prohibits polygamy, and then in the first version of the Book of Commandments, is it section 111 or whatever? Mm-hmm. It's saying polygamy is a no-no.
Right, right.
So it's a no-no before it's a yes-yes. Before it's a no-no.
Right.
Basically.
Before it's an oh-yes.
So her name was Elvira Field. I'm not making that up. And she comes rolling into Voree when she's 17 years old. And that's when Mr. Strang meets her. And he officially marries her as his second polygamous wife on July 13th, 1849. Just so you can see how long it took him to turn that around. Yeah, for reference, the Brighamites came out of the closet with polygamy in 1852 to the general world, even though in Salt Lake City it was openly practiced before that. But 1852 was the official coming out. So Strang takes Elvira on as his second wife. I think his first wife's name was Mary. Forgive me for not writing that down. She had three children with Strang. But by all accounts, she kind of thought he was a jerk, and their relationship fell apart once he took on Elvira. Now, what's funny about Elvira is at the same time that he starts jocking around with Elvira in secret, he gets a new secretary named Charlie, who travels around with him, who people say had suspicious curves. And later there's people who identified that Elvira was indeed Charlie, but Strang had the balls to go around with his plural. Like she, when she got married in 1849, she was 20. So she's this young woman. By all accounts, she was very intelligent, and he was really attracted to that element. And she became his kind of companion in running the church while he left Mary at home with the kids. But
it reminds me of the Life of Brian episode.
Yes.
Start him.
Yes. So you can see you're wearing a fedora and having a mustache painted on and everyone. You know, it's full on Shakespearean. I mean, does that really work? Does it ever really happen? But Charlie Elvira was a second polygamist wife. So why polygamy? We should pause to ask that question here. Well, quite frankly, at the time in Mormon theology, women were a commodity. That women were just another thing to be traded and owned. And so I think why, in my view, Strang eventually ended up practicing polygamy is the same reason they go after land, the same reason they go after money, the same reason they go after power. It is just another element of control. And when you're sitting at the top, if you can have eight wives, because it's a sign of authority. There's also a doctrinal reason for it. Joseph Smith taught quite a bit, and Young and those others picked it up, that your kingdom was your progeny, your offspring. So it was very important for these men to have as many children as they could have, because that's how they were building their own kingdoms that they would use to populate their own worlds as gods in the future. So it kind of was a natural outgrowth of the Mormon faith's just utter disregard for the feminine. There's nothing redeeming about the way polygamy was practiced. Matter of fact, in my belief, and maybe we'll do an episode on why I think this, I think Joseph and William and Bennett and those guys were basically just swinging, right? They were just like having a good time. That I can get down with. That makes sense, right? Like human beings like to screw each other. Okay, so do it. But it's when they start codifying and say, for me, but not for thee. And that's when, of course, and then the misfortune is really to the women that befall it.
Isn't that pretty much what primates do? Like if you look at gorillas, there's the alpha male, the grayback or whatever, and he gets as many female companions as he wants. And that's kind of what alpha males do as primates.
Depending, well, from what I've read is some primatologists have said, be careful with that construction. It's a little bit too, like, for example, chimpanzees do that, but they're extremely cheaty. So it's true that like the alphas have control of the ladies, but the ladies don't mind sneaking around behind their back. So a lot of adultery among the chimpanzees, from what I understand. Of course, the bonobos, ex-Mormons love talking about the bonobos, who they have sex constantly with everybody.
Right.
Okay. So our primate ancestors are rather randy, just like us. So I mean, when you get sex involved, it's not that surprising. Okay, so by July 8th, 1850, Strang, who has a fascination, if you read the book, the author keeps coming back to this theme over and over again. To me, it's not as interesting of a point. That the author argues that Strang was always obsessed with the idea of being a king and that sort of power. So on July 8th, 1850, he is crowned king. And it's important to note what he means by that. He meant that he was king of the church, because they call him king of Beaver Island. I call him the same thing. It's kind of derogatory, just because he anointed himself king on Beaver Island. I mean, he's king of Beaver Island, right? But I don't think Strang would say, I'm king of the United States or I'm king of the world. But he would have believed, and he did believe, that they were building the literal kingdom of God, and everybody would come and be subsumed. By the way, for those of you who aren't Mormons, the 12 apostles, which there's 15 of, still believe that this day. They believe that they are the rightful heirs of the entire government of the United States, and everyone will succumb to their leadership. Can you imagine what an awful place that would be? All right. Enough commentary. So he has himself coronated, and he uses a lot of the same stuff that he even drew in his little thing. We put up his little Raja Manchu thing before. If you're looking on your screen, the picture on the right, it shows the Raja, I guess, or maybe it's Strang. I don't know. But there's a guy who looks like he's holding a sword.
Kind of got a mohawk going on.
A mohawk or some kind of crown.
Definitely baked.
And he's got nice lashes. Those are definitely not extensions. There's an eye, and it looks like a scepter up above. And then there's a stylized version of the sun and a stylized version of the moon. But that moon is very, like, 19th century European moon. It has a face on it. And then there are
very Harry Connick Jr. Man in the moon. Yes. Smiling.
Each of those, the sun and the moon, have six crosses or six stars around them each. And then there are 10 bigger stars or 12 bigger stars, of which three have like long hats or something on them. Now the, how many spires are on the Salt Lake Temple? There's, it's complicated. Like there's the ones representing the Aaronic priesthood, the ones representing there's like six of them on each side. There's like 12 spires or something like that. But when he has himself crowned, he has his crown made of tin. And the author argues that that's because Strang thought it was shiny. I thought that was a little bit of a low blow. I thought that it was Strang oftentimes eschewed the wealth, but he had on robes, and they had actually got some Masonic regalia and some other things. And, you know, he literally sat on a throne with a scepter. As far as I know, Brigham never like donned the ermine like a cape or anything like that. I don't know that the church ever really had king regalia, but Strang did. God bless him. So he points himself king of the church, king of the kingdom of God, and things go south from there. On the island gets pretty raucous. The main city.
So I bet it's Lord of the Flies. I'm predicting kind of Lord of the Flies.
Well, you've got the fishermen and different people. They actually started creating their economy. The paddle boats or the steamships would stop there to refuel with wood. It ended up being a good place on there, and that's how they made their money on the church in the early days. And then, but in the early 1850s, Strang is buying things for like $1,000 parcels of land. So he's actually getting money and things coming in. They have a lot of disputes with the Gentiles around, a lot of it about control of that bay and who comes in and out and what's happening. And they eventually buy a cannon. So they have this 4-inch cannon that they have sitting in front of their temple or whatever that they point at the Gentiles when they're pissing them off or whatever. So by the way, all the people who were there at the coronation were the Fraternal Order of the Illuminati is what they were called. So the Strang had his Council of 50 called the Illuminati, and Joseph was, of course, the Council of 50. I didn't mention this, but it is worth mentioning. During his early days, before he went to Beaver Island, before he coronated himself, that kind of scared a lot of people away. He did get several notables. The William Smith, Joseph Smith's little brother, joined up with the Strangites for a while. Martin Harris is said to have communed with them, but Martin Harris never left Kirtland. I think that's a stretch to say that Martin Harris. And Martin Harris famously said, "I didn't leave the church left me." Well, got a point. William Marks joined with them. Johnny Page, we remember. Trustee and Trust of the Church, George Miller. Lucy Mack Smith, Joseph's mother, joined up with them. John C. Bennett did. So he pulled in a lot of luminaries. Most of these guys, if not all of them, eventually became disillusioned and left. And it was their disillusionment, and when they came back to Nauvoo, that really kick-started the reorganized church.
Did you already say Martin Harris?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah. So Martin Harris and Lucy Mack, that's a pretty big deal, I think.
Yeah. It was, and William Bennett was not, you know, he was a leader, and Johnny Page of the...
John C. Bennett or William Bennett?
William, or sorry, I keep saying that wrong. John C. Bennett joined with them for a while.
He was a scalawag. I'm not sure that's too... Well,
John, how do you take all of these people and point that this one's a... I want to know criteria.
He was involved in spiritual wifery. Look,
as opposed to Brigham Young?
There is a clear difference between spiritual wifery, which John C. Bennett was involved in, and celestial eternal marriage, which Joseph Smith was involved in. There's a huge difference.
You're just trying to cover the fact that you have drunk the Kool-Aid. Why do you believe John Bennett was a scoundrel and the rest of these guys weren't?
Because have you ever heard of the New and Everlasting Covenant? Have you ever read Brian C. Hale's ever? Are you paying attention? Are you paying attention, John?
Only
Larsen?
To the good parts. It's like when you buy a romance novel from a secondhand store, you kind of like drop it on the ground and see where the see which part is the most read. And that's the exciting part. Sorry, kids. I don't mean to give you, introduce you to the vice of the world. All right.
Can we wrap this up? I need to go to the romance section. I need to go test this theory.
Okay. Like all great men of this ilk, he was murdered in 1856. By four of his followers. Almost always these men are killed by their followers. Let's see. I pulled this paragraph actually from Wikipedia, so forgive me. On Monday, June 16th, 1856, Strang was waylaid around 7 p.m. on the dock in the harbor of St. James, the chief city on Beaver Island, by I think it was originally called Whiskey Flats or something like that, but by Wentworth and Bedford, who shot him in the back. All this was carried out in full view of several officers and men who were stationed at USS Michigan, U.S. Naval vessel, which was docked in the harbor. Now, the president at the time, I can't remember, who had actually sent federal troops to go and investigate what was going on there, like earlier in 1831. So during this whole period, I don't want to go into a full history of this, that things, just like Joseph Smith, things start getting bigger. They start getting out of control. There's violence. There's control. There's all that stuff. And eventually he is murdered, ending his reign. The church stays.
Real quick.
Yeah.
Do we know what the total membership was at the peak of its popularity?
I don't. I wish I did.
All right, dear listeners, if any of you want to Google or if any of you happen to know that, please comment in the comment section. Because I'm curious, was it dozens? Was it hundreds? Was it thousands?
It's still there. You know, like it's
still there now.
Yeah, they're still around, and there's like the Vorey Wisconsin Visitor Center that you can go to. They did leave Beaver Island and they just went back to Vorey, where they've stayed and been in continuous operation. They prefer they're the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, and they see the term Strangite as a slight. Kind of like Mormons today see the word Mormon.
Yeah, as a victory for Satan.
As a victory for Satan. Yeah. Well, I actually don't know if that's what they think or not, but I know they don't advertise themselves as Strangites. So I'm just giving them the benefit of the doubt. Okay. So let's kind of recap. You know, I told you at the beginning, and we've paused a couple times to belabor this point for you to kind of think about your feelings as you saw what we did is we laughed. We thought this was funny. Right. He has an angelic visitation by an angel that visits him and says to him, you're selected, you're the one. He has a follow-up angelic visit that gives him a gift of the Urim and Thummim. He goes to a place that's designated and he finds ancient records, which he digs up and has witnesses who validate that they are ancient records. He translates those records by the power of God and produces scripture. And that scripture itself, again, validates that he was chosen as the prophet to lead in the time. More so than Joseph Smith, he is appointed by a previous prophet. Joseph Smith did not have a John the Baptist. Strang did. And the letter has been authenticated. He was able to convert apostles. So if you believe in the Mormon Church
and a member of one of the first witnesses.
Yeah. You would believe these guys had the power of discernment. If you do not believe the 12 have powers of discernment, then you just as well join Kara's church, right? Maybe your church would be better.
Church of Kara.
Right. Like if you're going to be a Mormon or part of the Mormon verse, then you're going to believe that being a special witness of Christ and a prophet, seer, and revelator means something and not nothing. So he's able to convince even the very elect, right? He's able to keep his church together. Joseph Smith bragged that no man, not even Jesus Christ, could keep his church together. This church is still functioning in 2021, right? And they say, well, they dwindled in numbers. There's plenty of accounts in the Bible suggesting that there were not very many people, you know, a Lot and his wife, and she didn't even make it, that harpy. So, you know, me, that's for me in my house, you know, the idea that the very righteous will dwindle in numbers is established by scriptural preference. So he was able to convince people. He was able to find artifacts. He was able to create and translate scripture. He was able to reproduce everything that Joseph did. Now the question, why would anybody find Joseph's compelling and this one not compelling? Because my contention is you probably found at least some part, if you were a believing member of the church, of the series of events that correspond with Joseph Smith, the first vision, you know, his visitation from Moroni, the translation of the Book of Mormon, all that probably tickled your feelings at some point and made you feel like this, the Spirit was talking to you. So why is the one story compelling and not the other?
Is that a rhetorical question?
Yeah. Yeah. It's a real question for real believers of the Mormon church, because Strang seems more like a prophet than Young. And it's a future podcast. Everything Young ever predicted came wrong. He didn't get anything right. So
Young didn't even call himself a prophet, really.
Like, not in the beginning.
Yeah.
But he did later, and he made prophecies. And they were wrong. So you know, what does this mean for the movement? Well, I think what it means to me, and again, I wish we could have a call-in show right here, what people have to say. For me, it really should show Mormons that their foundational story is not very compelling at all. Like, people go out to the Hill Cumorah Visitor Center, and there'll be these elderly, really strong believing, super nice docents out there walking people around, walking into this forest, you know, this sacred grove. And for Mormons who have already believed, who've already given over their belief to this system, it produces religious experience. It is meaningful. Like that this 14-year-old boy in upstate New York says an angel visited him. But what I'm trying to tell you is that story is not compelling to anybody. And when you see somebody else tell those kind of stories, you're not convinced. These things that are speak spiritual to spiritual meaning and purpose to Mormons don't have meaning outside of that context. And I don't think, unless people are being manipulated, which oftentimes as a former missionary, I was an unsuccessful missionary, but I was a missionary. I know what I was trained to do. We were trained to look for emotionally, psychologically vulnerable people and prey upon their vulnerabilities to separate them from their family, introduce them to a new family. And then we would tell them, it literally said in the discussions, what you're feeling is the Spirit. We would coach their feelings. That's a good feeling. That's a bad feeling. When you feel this, you're feeling the right thing. When you're feeling this, you're feeling the wrong thing. And what Strang should teach you is that the tricks that Joseph Smith employed are easy to reproduce, at least for experts, right? And they're easy to one up. I watch magicians today, and I can't tell you how they do some of their tricks. I don't know how they saw people in half. Well, I kind of do, but not really. But I know that they're tricking me, because I can tell by the way they're standing. I can tell by the way they're holding their hands. When I watch a magic show, magicians are not acting like normal people do. They act weird. So I take that as a red flag. Prophets, quote unquote, do not act like real people. They act weird. And that should be a warning sign to you that you are being manipulated, that you are being lied to. I don't think that God, if there is a God, needs to have us rely on secondhand, needs to talk to 14-year-old kids and have 14-year-old kids tell us what that story is. I don't think God needs, itinerant Baptist ministers who go and declare themselves to be king to tell us what to do. I think that God can find better methods. And I think what this story really does, it lays bare that the foundation of Mormonism is a bunch of horse shit. Oh. There's your PG-13.
Right? Tell us what you really think, Brother John.
Come on, John. Have you...
you know, can I have just a tiny bit as well?
Please, the
Mormon church wants it two ways. They want us to respect the three witnesses and Lucy, the mother of Joseph Smith. And we need to well, Lucy's a valid witness of Joseph's divinity or divine sanction. And Martin Harris is one of the three witnesses. So, and they're super credible. In fact, the, you know, Daniel Peterson and the Interpreter Foundation or whatever just released a movie, a cinematic Hollywood style movie on the amazingness of the three witnesses. I'm guessing that James Strang was left out of the script on that celebratory movie, but the apologists have wanted it and the church have wanted it both ways for a long time. That on the one hand, we need to celebrate, you know, the mother of Joseph and the three witnesses and the eight witnesses. And on the other hand, forget anything that they did or believed or followed afterwards. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And that, I think that should be, concerning to fair-minded people reviewing the evidence.
I think it's a really good point. I also think that there is this issue that showed up when the Brighamites, when the Salt Lake Corporation announced that we were no longer allowed to use the word Mormon. There is such hubris coming out of Salt Lake City because there are hundreds and hundreds of denominations still today who trace themselves back to Joseph Smith. There are hundreds of thousands of people in the United States, in the world today, if not into the millions, if you start counting like the community of Christ, who are part of this whole network. And the Mormons, the Salt Lake City Mormons, like to paint the other denominations. Notice I use the word denomination. They use the word schism, right? The schismatics, the apostates. You know, and they look at all of these people like these branches of a tree, and they like push this branch. Look at how ridiculous this branch is. They are claiming to be prophets. They're marrying multiple women. They're moving to you know, like the colonies and all this stuff, but they all do exactly the same things. You know, there's really not any material difference other than one has become extremely financially successful. But as somebody who's, you know, who's marginally interested in actual Mormon doctrine or Mormon theology, which doesn't come up, but we're bringing it up pretty soon. We'll tease that for a minute. Actual Mormon theology, the theological underpinnings of these different movements aren't significantly different. Somebody, a scholar reading about Mormonism 500 years from now would have a hard time identifying that this was a Strangite writing. This was a writing from, you know, from Short Creek. This was a writing from, the Nauvoo, you know, reorganized period. This was a writing from Salt Lake. It would all just be a mishmash of the same bullshit.
Yeah.
So the thing, the message there, I want to give the Salt Lake people who think they can control the word Mormon, you're not that special. And when you look at these other guys and see, there's a bunch of weirdos, that's how the rest of us see you. I believed it too. So I'm just being a dick, but you know, I was full in and fully believed it and all that kind of stuff. And I fully believe when I would read about the reorganized church and celebrate every failure they had and take pride in every hardship that they ran into, you know, that in 1856, Strang wasn't the only Mormon who was assassinated. Parley P. Pratt was assassinated that year also by the estranged husband of a woman he absconded with. So it's easy to look and say, oh yeah, well, clearly the Strangites was a false church because he was murdered. But I drive up Parley's Canyon all the time.
Right. Yeah. And I think when you're in the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints small d mindset, it's like, well, we have numbers, so we won. And we've got the money and the power, so we won. But you just, well, that means the Catholic Church is true. You know what I mean? Like,
right.
We're compared to however many billion people are on the earth, we're still teeny and we're shrinking, you know, relatively speaking.
Look at
soon we will be
the growth of the Pentecostal movement. What was it in 1918? When the founder predicted the earthquake, and then, and that movement has grown to hundreds of millions of people in 100 years. So if you want to use, which Mormons do, the fact of quick growing religions, you know, they're not even in contention for the top spots, right? So I think what happens is Brighamites tend to have this list of, they have this big long list of items that prove that they're the true church. And I contend that everything on their list you can find in another, but they'll just scoff and mock and dismiss. Yeah. So I understand the mocking. I mean, I get that part, but it just, I mean, all of it just seems so weird today. That's what, as somebody, I was talking to a new friend, and I realized it'd been 16 years for me since I went to the church as a member. Right.
Yeah.
And it just all seems so bizarre now. It just seems so like, it's not compelling at all. When you have this book, like the Book of Mormon, that has all this stuff and that's demonstrably unscientific, that's demonstrably not true. And it has this like regurgitated half-assed theology that you can find in the Bible, and everything that defines Mormonism is not really in there. Like, why? What is the driver? Well, when you pull it away, it's like, because I've been trained to believe. Why would a 14-year-old boy claiming he saw an angel in bed be a compelling story for anybody? Because you were told it was, over and over and over, in many ways, in songs, in prayers, in whispers, in
since you're a baby,
status
every week at church for 3 hours or 2 hours for your entire life.
So if you found Strang ridiculous, well, Mormon Joseph was ridiculous. Because they really are tied together. And you can say one was just copying the other, but one could say that about the Mormon church in entirety. You know, where did they get their idea for how to build chapel? You go to the Kirtland Temple, it sure looks like every other country church.
Yeah. And even if you go to the copycat thing, I was reading Fawn Brody's No Man Knows My History. There was Lumen Walters running around claiming sacred texts and claiming to find treasure before Joseph Smith was doing it, or Sally Chase. Like, if you want to say Joseph was the original, he wasn't the original. He was basically copying a whole lot of things,
right,
that he was swimming in. That was his talent, was sort of, as Terrell Givens would like to frame it now, he was an inspired syncretist.
Well, I mean, look at like the Shakers and Mother, oh, what was Mother? Mother Mary, Mother, the one.
Mary Baker Eddy or White or
yeah,
Mary
White. The Millerites. Yeah. Even I mean, within a stone's throw of Joseph Smith, there were prophets were a dime a dozen at the time.
Yeah.
And it's to the winners go the spoils, you know? And this story can be compelling because they won.
Yeah. Winners get to write the history.
Winners get to write the history.
And you've already touched on this, but I had to bring up this analogy because it really helped drive it home for me. You made the point that the last refuge of Mormons, of faithful Latter-day Saints, is their feelings. That, well, but I feel yucky when you tell the story of James Strang, but I feel warm, fuzzy, you know, cold tinglings down my back when I think about Joseph Smith or hear the Mormon Tabernacle Choir. And then I thought about like how much I loved Rush's 2112 album growing up. Like, I loved Rush. All their albums were great, but 2112 was super special. Mm-hmm. And so I would listen to it over and over and over again. At first I heard my siblings listening to it. I'd hear it on, you know, 96X rock station. I would listen to it over and over again. And before I knew it, I knew that Rush 2112 was the Lord's one true LP. It was. I've even got some people nodding here. And then I would share it with other people who didn't have that same history with it. And they would just look at me and go, this is weird. This is loud. This sounds dumb. And I'd be like, how can you not feel the Holy Spirit of 2112 descend upon you like an angel or a dove, sending tinglies down your spine? And the difference is they didn't have their older siblings listening to it. They didn't listen to it for years and years and years. They didn't have all the memories associated with listening to it, driving down the car with your buddies with the windows down, rocking out to Neil Peart and Geddy Lee and Alex Lifeson. And then you just realize all those emotions. It turns out that the Holy Ghost within Mormonism feels a lot like social approval.
Mm-hmm. There is a book I'm going to recommend called The Manipulated Mind by Dennis Wynn, W-I-N-N. The Manipulated Mind, subtitled Brainwashing, Conditioning, and Indoctrination. He focuses mostly on what happens to prisoners of war. It was a really important book that I read when I was deconstructing Mormonism for myself. There's a couple of points that they come away with, which is, you know, you've seen lots of movies where people resist torture. You can't. No one can. It can't be done. They will change your psychology if it's the CIA or whatever. They will win. They will beat you. And he does talk about how they not only can get you to spill whatever secrets you have, they'll get you to love them. You'll have real feelings of affection for your torturers when they come into the chamber.
Like Elizabeth Smart eventually did for Brian David Mitchell.
Right. Elizabeth Smart is a great example of that. And It happens over and over and over again. And how we can.
Patty Hearst with, you know, her kill.
Yes.
Carah Burrell at Mormon Stories. What? Just kidding.
it's the unfortunately, the roadmap for how to manipulate the psychology of human beings has been discovered. And it is a playbook that the church uses. And unfortunately, it is so effective that you'll have grown, educated adults who have been taught, who have been conditioned to have certain emotional responses to certain things, and they full on believe that. I mean, that's what, when I, you know, you talk about Terrell Givens and Fiona, I really, really enjoy Terrell's book, By His Own Hand. I would recommend that, and we're going to do a podcast here of what I recommend, the faithful books that I recommend to read, and that's one of them. I would stay clear of the rest of his stuff, but that one's good.
The rest of his.
It's just because it doesn't, he's a beautiful man. He's an admirable person. It's just what he's peddling now has nothing to do with Mormonism. Right. But you have these people who are very, very intelligent and understand the way the world works, but cannot see the operant conditioning that has been installed in their own self, which is why ridicule, and the stuff that I engage in is not by accident, because what I'm doing, dear reader, is I'm breaking your operant conditioning by engaging in taboo.
So it's not just as simple as you're an ass. It's not that simple.
Well, I mean,
it's
that more... helps.
It's like, for that.
It's like becoming the president of the United States. You have to have lots of money and a big mouth, right? So I don't have either. Well, I have one of those, not the other. Yeah, this, the assholery helps. It's an important breaking taboos and those sort of things, an important part, because this conditioning is really super strong. You do not have to take my word for it. I could give you a list of 25 books by renowned psychologists. This is John, you're a renowned psychologist. Am I making this shit up?
No, you're not. Check out Luna Corbden's recovering agency. We have a 12-hour series on all the ways that high demand religions or cults use undue influence, but this is absolutely central.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So I think Strang's story is interesting. It's a tragedy. I don't, you know, this poor guy, I don't, whatever. And the people who followed him, that there's victims on victims on victims on victims. We're all religion, in my view, exploits weakness in human psychology. And it's an unmoved mover. It's these systems that get in place, you know, no one drop thinks it's responsible for the flood. No one drop of water thinks it's responsible. And that's why the Mormon church and these other things are so successful, because they're really hard to unwind. You think if Dallin Oaks got up today and said, I think it's all a fraud, it would fall apart? No. Everyone's been conditioned to take that. He would be destroyed. He would be ruined. He would lose things. And people like you and I, you know, we who come up here, we suffer a little bit of blows, not anything major, but we are going against, we are swimming upstream in this culture here, and people are conditioned not to hear what they don't want to hear. All of us. And I don't think this is, because a lot of you listening have deconstructed Mormonism. Be careful. There are other movements that are pulling people in.
What was that?
Oh, I said MAGA. Yeah, MAGA. I'm talking to you guys. You're a cult. So it has to happen one time in the episode. There are other.
These views are not necessarily representative of the Open Stories Foundation.
Obviously. I'm going to call your bullshit. Are you really defending MAGA?
Nope, I'm not.
Okay.
I look like I'd be MAGA. Is that good enough?
There are movements on the left that are equally, I don't want to sound like I'm just again, there are movements on the right, there are movements on the left. We are susceptible to false information. We're susceptible to false information to such a degree that when it is demonstrated to be false, I'll use QAnon. I was watching a little interview with a QAnon adherent who believes, as some QAnon adherents believe now, that Donald Trump is still the president of the United States, because one of QAnon's big beliefs was that he was going to be reinstated, that there was this big movement against the pedophiles and all that kind of stuff, and that he was going to be reinstated. And there was an interview with one of these guys, and they presented the question, well, then was Donald Trump responsible for the pullout in Afghanistan?
Oops.
He literally just couldn't answer. It broke his firmware.
Or the vaccine mandates or whatever.
He couldn't, you could see his eye, it's like a cartoon. His eyes start spinning around. I'm not making fun of this person. We are all that person. Yeah. There are truths that we have been conditioned not to want to confront. There's lies we tell ourselves, and we all have to, and it's really easy to point fingers at MAGA. It's really easy to point fingers at the Mormons. But the real trick is to look inside.
Yeah. I see it all the time. I see so many ex-Mormons leave Mormonism and then acquire just new magic worldviews that are sometimes just as disturbing, if not more disturbing. Mm-hmm. I have a couple friends that are ER docs here in Utah and in Nevada, and they're telling these stories now of these patients coming in. They come into the ER room, or they come into the emergency room. They say, I'm dying. Help me. The doctor says, okay, let me figure out what's going on. Does a test, got COVID, they didn't get vaccinated. They're in the intensive care unit getting intubated, and they're arguing with the doctor saying, I don't have COVID. You're lying. This is a conspiracy. Somebody's paying you to diagnose me with COVID when I don't really have it. I refuse to believe that I have COVID. And they come to the ER dying, and many of them die, arguing with the doctor as they take their last breath. Mm-hmm. Weird.
Yeah, it's really sad, because COVID is a terrible way to die. It really is. They suffocate to death, and it's miserable. It's misery, and it gives me so much pain to see the amount of suffering that's happening that doesn't have to. But it also helps us understand just how susceptible and vulnerable humankind is to misinformation. How cautious we have to be. And just committed to being, to really being careful.
Yeah.
Maybe we should address the do your own research thing. You've got to be careful when you do research. You've got to understand what you're looking at. You know, one of the reasons I've been successful in learning Mormon history is I pay very close attention to who the author is, what's their bias, where are they writing from? Where does this fit in with everything? How does this affect the other things? Which is why whenever I tell these stories from Mormonism, I always like to plug it into everything else that's going on, because we tend to pull these things out of context. Just like people who are leaving the military because they're required to get a vaccine, even though they've already been required to get 30 vaccines. It just makes your head scratch and say, what are you talking about? I read recently it was a southern state, maybe Tennessee. They had their first death from rabies in 70 years because the person refused to get the vaccine. Like that shows the level of, again, I'm not trying to make this political. I'm trying to say that's weird, right? Because they had taken this thing that became political and then turned it into something else, anti-vaccine, and then they refused a life-saving treatment. There's no reason.
It's like an antidote, right?
To die.
You get rabies, right. You get bitten, you're starting to die, and they can give you an antidote to cure the rabies.
And right.
Saying they,
and if they had said, we'll give you the antidote, the person probably would have taken it.
But they used the word vaccine. Because that had been politicized.
They used the word vaccine and they died of rabies. What a terrible way to die.
Yeah.
You know, so we have to be careful.
Yeah. Yep. Critical thinking skills. And we all need to be aware. It's not just Orthodox Mormons. It's all of us. It's
right.
Ex-Mormons included.
Ex-Mormons included. And whenever you're an ex-Mormon, I'll say this controversial thing. I've said it many times. Ex-Mormons are just Mormons. You have to understand that when you're first leaving the church, all those constructions, all those way of thinking, all the emotional response is still there. And a lot of ex-Mormons deal with that by inverting it, which is not necessarily a bad strategy, but it is still a strategy. It takes a while to land on your feet. That's okay. First of all, Mormons successfully navigate this world. You know, we talk as if they people wander out of the church and they don't know how to like tie their shoes or anything like that. That's not the case. But it is extremely disorienting, and a disorientation that lasts for years, and a disorientation that you oftentimes can't recognize. As if you talk to old salty ex-Mormons, you know, they can tell, they can laugh at themselves as they went through these stages, but hopefully they arrive in a healthy place saying, well, the asshole I became as an ex-Mormon for that first year was still a function of Mormonism.
Yeah.
Right. Mormonism produces ex-Mormons. Right. So ex-Mormons, Mormonism, just like Mormonism is a contributing cause of juvenile suicide. That's clear. In the state of Utah, even though you can't find a causal direct connection. Well, you can some places. It's in Miracle Forgiveness, right? Mm. Where it says they said it's better to die than lose your virtue.
Yeah.
So it's heady stuff, but you're doing okay. Take it at your own speed.
I mean, if you're listening to John Larsen, chances are you're doing better than a lot of people.
If you made it this far.
So
exciting news. I've been packing. I've been telling you I'm moving. I've been packing all my books. So I've been pulling aside some gems, some things that are not talked about very often, some interesting segments from the world of Mormonism. So I'm excited about this next year and the things and topics more, we're going
to
talk about.
Are you saying there's more to come? There's more John Larsen to come?
There is more to come, and some really fascinating things. We're going to take some time going through what other people said about the Mormons. I think, you know, again, we always take it out of context, but the Mormons were around, and there were people who came to Salt Lake to see what was going on, including Mark Twain. And I think it's interesting to look at some of what they said about the Mormons and their culture. I think that there have been some really brilliant people who've written inside and outside Mormonism about theological underpinnings and some of the more interesting things Joseph said, which we tend to ignore. So I think we've got some interesting podcasts coming up.
I love it. And as I'm looking at the Mormon Expression app on Anchor, Mormon Expression is available in at least 7 different platforms now, thanks to you, our listeners who support the Mormon Expression project. And 76,000 total plays so far of your podcast. Some of the episodes have over 1,000, almost 2,000 listens. So that's amazing progress for a podcast that was kind of only recently relaunched. So
yeah,
that's super fun. You're going to reach, I bet by the next time you're in front of us, you'll hit 100,000 plays.
Which is good. Which is super cool. I hope it's helpful. You know, it was a,
It is. It is. So thanks to everyone who has supported the Mormon Expression Initiative on Mormon Stories podcast. If you either value John Larsen coming on Mormon Stories, or you really value the Mormon Expression library now being made available, please go to mormonstories.org/Mormon Expression. Your donations go to support John and the Mormon Expression Project. We are paying John for his time. We're happy to be doing that. John, I hope you got paid this month. If you didn't, we'll get right on that. But but just thank you so much for everyone who has supported or will support the Mormon Expression Project. Again, you just go to mormonstories.org/Mormon Expression, click on the donate button, become a monthly donor, and we'll just keep having John back. We're actually, because John's moving, we're going to use some of your money to buy a high quality camera, high quality microphone and mixer, and set John up, so that maybe John could even appear more than once a month sometimes. Is that exceeding your contract? Will the Workers' Rights Administration or the union, Screen Actors Guild, are they going to, I mean,
I don't have my SAG card yet. no, I think that'll be fine. I do it as often as I want. And we'll go full circle to the back, to the front of what I was talking about. I titrate how much I do this to preserve my own mental health.
Yeah.
And I would suggest, I mean, there's stages when you, dear listener, dear viewer, want to binge this stuff. I get it. I binged for a lot of years, but it's good to go. The world is a beautiful place still. It's good to put down the computer sometimes.
I keep trying to tell Kara we're putting out too much content, and she just says, no, we got to keep going.
Yeah. I'm not feeling Stockholm syndrome right now at all.
I am curious. Listeners, do we put out too much content on Mormon Stories Podcast? I want to know right now. Comment and let us know, because we're torn, because it seems like sometimes the more content, the more happy people are. And then we start to wear out. So anyway, let us know, listeners, if you want less content and you'll still support us. I'd be thrilled to ramp it down, to ratchet it down a little bit. But Kara, she won't stop.
I won't stop. I wish we had a pre-show, post-show, commercial break in the middle of just chit-chat. I just want to chat all day long.
It's true. All right, Brother John, anything else you want to say before we close?
No, I appreciate all the kindness for everyone out there. Just take care of each other. That's all we got.
Be kind to each other. Be good to each other. I love it. And listeners, thanks to everyone who the chat comments today were off the charts. So many good chats on both YouTube and Facebook. Thanks to everyone who joins us live. We had an audience of over 500 people simultaneous. It's a great audience. So many good chats. I wish we could show all your chats. And so many people were generous on YouTube donating through the Super Chat feature. We really appreciate when you do that. It just helps keep the lights on, frankly, and the broadband on and everything else. So anyway, more awesome John Larsen to come. Be kind and good to each other. Kara, any final words?
Oh, can I just do one quick summary of what I think this episode was about?
Oh, we got to plug Thrive too, but yes.
Yeah, we got to plug Thrive too. Yeah, everyone come out to Thrive, November 14th. One of my favorite quotes is the idea of why would God create creatures capable of reason and then demand that they act in a manner contrary to their creation? And it just reminded me when John Larsen was going through all the different denominations of Mormonism and the things that we can see as an outsider to their tribe, we can see things that look fallacious and look silly. And we can say that, okay, God created us to look at this and we know that we're not going to be defrauded by another Bernie Madoff or whoever coming along. But then God asks for us to put that on a shelf for this particular brand of Mormonism. And there's, again, a couple thousand different brands of this type of religion anyway. So it does beg the question, how we know what we know when we are Mormon or we're Mormon. So that's what it comes down to me. That's the baseline. That's the summary that I think this podcast is much about. So. And then anyway, yeah, go ahead and plug Thrive, guys. Go on to Thrive.
Great thoughts.
Yeah. So Thrive, we're having a conference. The whole purpose of Thrive. Thrive is a for loss organization. In other words, not only is it not for profit, we are guaranteed we're going to be losing tens of thousands of dollars at this Thrive coming up at the Salt Palace in a week and a half. But that's how much our current underwriters believe in providing you with friends and community and tools and tricks and tips to support you in your journey. So if you guys feel interested, we have an amazing lineup of speakers. November 14th includes Lance Allred, former NBA basketball player, first legally deaf NBA basketball player, Sarah Edmondson, a former NXIVM cult survivor, I guess, NXIVM cult survivor, actress on the HBO's The Vow. She's also co-host with her husband, Nippy. I think that's how you say his name, for a Little Bit Culty podcast. But she's coming out. We've got RFM, Radio Free Mormon, Bill Reel, Natasha Helfer, me, Luna Corbden, Alan and Katie Mount for Marriage on a Tightrope. I know that I'm, Latter-day Lesbians, like I know I'm forgetting. Plus a bunch of cool TikTokers. Do you want to rifle off their names, Kara?
Ex-Mormon Mindy. Kyleen, me, Jordan and McKay, who are also YouTubers as well. They have a really great YouTube account and channel where they make content almost every week. They're competing with us now. They're doing some good stuff. Jack Mormon, who makes hilarious TikTok videos, Exmo Lex, and Devil Trout. So lots of different other people that are popular on the TikTok platform as well. And then there's also going to be a little party the night before Thrive, which we'll give more details about. But if you go to the Mormon Stories Instagram page, you will see some more details there. But yeah, we're gonna have a party. There's gonna be a cash bar that you can buy drinks at. You can dance and karaoke. So it's like a whole Saturday night and all of Sunday, just like friends.
So wait, people can karaoke with you, Kara Burrell?
Yeah, with you, John DeLynn.
Does the whole world know that John DeLynn loves karaoke?
I think it's probably obnoxiously well known at this point.
But sober karaoke, which is sort of, it's like
I fear the
come
world.
Come out for sober karaoke from John DeLynn. No, you'll think it's an sober oxymoron, but it's
sober
not.
Sober karaoke is like going to a nudist colony in a snowsuit. What's the point?
It's fascinating. It's like a psychology study.
It's almost like visiting Beaver Island.
Yes. The beaver were all gone. Hey, you teased it the last podcast. Who's going to take over and do Thrive Portland? I commit that I will help, but I ain't going to lead that thing.
Yeah, so we're actually, so we are coming to, if you're in Alpine, Lehigh, or Highland, we're coming, we're at a Traverse Mountain this Sunday, November 7th. We're going to hold a little get-together at 11 a.m., brunch. There's going to be a food truck there, coffee. And the whole purpose, it's free. The only reason we're doing that is because I am sick of so many families from Alpine, Lehigh, or Highland coming to me saying, we're the only people that have lost their faith in Alpine, Lehigh, or Highland. We're alone here. We don't know anybody. And there are hundreds of families in that area that have all left the church, and they all think they're the only ones. So I literally just said, I'm sick of it. Gosh dang it, I'm not taking this anymore. We scheduled an event at Traverse Mountain Clubhouse, 11 a.m., Sunday, November 7th. And we're just going to show up, and I'll say a few words only because that might help a few more people come. And you all can meet each other, become friends, form book clubs, form play groups, form swinger club. No, don't do swinger. And you can just find friends and community so that you can have a healthy, happy emergence from Orthodox Mormonism. And the reason why I'm saying that is I want to do that wherever there's a need. So if Tooele wants John Larsen to come out and just say hi, we'll have John Larsen come out. Or Carah Burrell will come to freaking Ogden or Utah County. I don't know where. And we just want to have these mini events that are free where just you guys can all meet, start a Facebook group, meet each other, start friends, and build community. And we want to do it in Portland and Seattle and SoCal. And because I think the number one thing people want are just friends and community to do life with, kind of like the living community.
Well, after being around here for 15, 16, 20 years, whatever it's been, these groups, the ex-Mormonism goes through these waves where there will be a strong community, and oftentimes a strong community network across the United States. And the problem is, this is very healthy. They break down for good reasons, which is people move on with their lives. Yeah. And we could go through the genealogy of these people who have, and you can probably think picture them in your mind, and I can too, John. People have put their heart and soul into these things. And then after 4 or 5 years, they move on. And we need new generations of people. These meeting other people in real life is really important. And it's really healthy, and it's going to be even more important and more healthy in the coming months as hopefully we get COVID a little bit under control and we emerge not only from our cocoons. I am really honestly concerned about the number of people who left the church during the last year and a half, 2 years, and not had that kind of support. It is critical, but it's not going to be done by people sitting in their throne like John DeLynn. It's going to be done by local people who are making things happen and who can know which coffee shop can have 20 people sit in it. It's not hard. It's just somebody has got to take the first arrow. And you know what? There's going to be people who don't show up. I have hosted events where nobody came.
No.
I have hosted events where 300 people came. Why? But it's not you. You're going to think people, you know, oh, they don't like me. I'm not. It needs to be somebody. Somebody has got to put their plate down. And that's what John's saying. And not, it's not like a celebrity worship sort of thing. It's that there are those of us who know that they'll come out to see, because I'm your friend in the radio. I'm the voice in the box. So at least there's a little bit of novelty to see, is he really is goofy in real life. And I'm happy to do that, to help people find those relationships and friendships that are going to help them cross the threshold. And eventually you're going to leave those and you're going to take some friends with you and you're going to make new friends, and it's going to be great. Mormonism taught you to be isolated. You don't need to be isolated.
I was talking to Alan Mount this morning, and it's this idea of finding your pod. Mm-hmm. So often we've created these secular communities thinking that they would last and they all die. But what often happens is the people that come, if there's enough people come, you meet 3 or 4 families that you really like, and you end up breaking off, stopping your participation in these communities. And that's all you need is 3 or 4 or 5 couples that you can hang out with. Kids are relatively similar age sometimes. And you can do decades of a really high quality of life with just a small pod of three or four families. I think so.
I mean, that's what psychologically we, if you're in a healthy place, you tend to have a very few number of close friends and then a bigger circle of acquaintances. And this is how you find those by, and it takes sitting in the parking lot and getting the courage to go in. It is hard. I've actually at some of these things gone, I've been the asshole. I've gone out in the parking lot and knocked on the windows to bring people in from time to time. It's scary.
We did a retreat just a couple weeks ago, and we asked people two questions at the beginning. How many of you almost turned around and went home? And there were like 15 hands that went up out of 40 people. Mm-hmm. And I'm sure there were people that paid but just didn't show. But the other thing is, we asked how many people had to lie to somebody to come, and like half the hands go up. You know, because that's when you meet with Mormon Voldemort, you got to lie to your parents to get them to babysit your kids, basically. Anyway, we've belabored this enough. I do want to make a call out. Shannon Flynn did pass away. We have some listeners who are writing in, and, you know, condolences to the Flynn family, to his surviving spouse, and to all the Flynn family and friends. We had Shannon Flynn on earlier this year. He was wonderful and an important figure in Mormon history, and a really complex, tortured soul in many ways. But shout out to Shannon Flynn, wherever you are or aren't, and condolences to your friends and family.
And that does remind me also, we had another great pass away. You probably already addressed it. The end of September, Will Bagley passed.
You had him on Mormon Expression.
I did. He was a brilliant, fascinating, lovely human being. And he was one of the good ones. And his work is way more influential than his name, and he'll be sorely missed.
Yeah. All right. I think we've belabored this enough. Hey, everybody. Thanks so much for joining us. Be good to each other. Stay away from Beaver Island if you can. And we'll see you guys all again soon on another episode of Mormon Stories Podcast. Take care, everybody.